We can start the program. Sanu sir. Sanu sir.
Hello all. Today.
Radhika teacher is not audible. Sanu sir, please take over.
Hey, warm good afternoon to all of you. Today is the 5th day of VIRTUOSA2020, the webinar series organized by IQAC team KSMDB College, Shastangota. Let us start the function with a prayer. This current time is audible.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
An excellent video. In the current time, where we are having too much of difficulty across the world, and currently also we are facing a lot of issues regarding technology. May the prayer help us to continue the session without any drawback. So let me start with the official job of welcoming all the guests for the day. A leader is one who knows the way, goes the way, and shows the way. The words of John C. Maxwell, the famous American author. Our beloved principal, Dr. K. S. Anil Kumar, is the living example for the quote, and he is the man behind VIRTUOSA 2020. On behalf of the entire team of VIRTUOSA 2020, and on my personal behalf also, I wish to welcome you, sir, to the 5th day of webinar series.
Thank you.
In the midst of lockdown, the academics and industry is using online technology platform to communicate and deliver results. The resource person for the day, Dr. Elizabeth Sherly, is the professor of a technology-driven entity, Indian Institute of Information Technology and Management, Kerala, popularly known as IQAC. Team VIRTUOSA 2020 is grateful to you, madam, for giving us a slot today from your very busy schedule, and I take this opportunity to welcome you to this session.
Thank you very much.
Customer is considered to be the king of any business model. the customers can decide whether the business will succeed or not. The real customer of Virtuosa 2020 is the attendees. We have 400 plus registration for today's session, which includes eminent research guests, reputed faculty members of various institutes, and vibrant research scholars. On behalf of IQAC team, I take this opportunity to thank you all for believing the brand Virtuosa 2020, and we welcome you all to the fifth day of the webinar series. I also take this opportunity to welcome Dr. Mini P. Nair, Associate Professor of English Department, KSMDB College, Sastangota, who joined us today to facilitate the function.
Thank you, Swami.
Faculty members of KSMDB College wholeheartedly supported the entire team Virtuosa 2020. I wish to welcome you all to the fifth day of the event. For the sake of formality, let me welcome all organizers also to this session. Now we will move to the presidential address from our beloved principal, Dr. K.S. Anil Kumar.
Good afternoon to everybody. Welcome to Virtuosa 2020, the fifth day of the seminar series. So today we are lucky with the presence of one of the eminent professor in computer science, Dr. Elizabeth Sherly, the former director of IQAC. And as you know that we are facing a lot of barriers for the dissemination of knowledge because of the unprecedented situations that are carried out in the world. So we are trying to make more effective the system of teaching learning process. All universities and colleges are closed down due to the unprecedented situations that happened due to the outbreak of Corona 19 pandemic. See, in this situation, the KSMDB College, one of the pioneer educational institution of Travancore Devasam Board, is hosting a webinar series which comprising seven eminent faculty members talk through the online platform. So the inaugural talk by Dr. Sabu Thomas, the Honorable Vice Chancellor of Mahatma Gandhi University. And this talk is exclusively for the new modern technologies which can be used in the COVID-19 scenario. The teaching, learning, and research methodologies which we usually practice is now changing to a new domain. That is, we can't imagine the situation that the teaching, learning process is direct or teacher-centric or student-centric, which is directly face-to-face interactions. Now it is entirely a different situation that see the platform, the use of latest trends of the technology, that is IT, we are transferring the knowledge. And see, under this situation, I'm very happy that, see, the KSMDB College, one of the arts and science college, takes this role for transferring of knowledge with the use of this IT platform. And I have personally a commitment to Dr. Elizabeth Sherly also. She helped me a lot in my research work. And she's a good teacher, an academician. Moreover, that she is a human being. So on behalf of KSMDB College, I expressed my deep gratitude to Elizabeth Sherly once again. And please listen here. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anil Kumar.
Thank you, sir. We don't acknowledge motivation as the focus. On behalf of the IQAC team, you need to
Thank you.
പരമ്പരാഗത രീതിയാണ് അറിവാർജിക്കുന്നതിന്, പഠിക്കുന്നതിന്, പഠിപ്പിക്കുന്നതിന് നാം ഇക്കാലം അത്രയും സ്വീകരിച്ചു പോന്നിരുന്നത്. ഒരധ്യാപകൻ, ഒരു ക്ലാസ് റൂം, അതിൽ കുറെ വിദ്യാർത്ഥികൾ, അവരോട് അധ്യാപകൻ സംവദിക്കുന്നു, ക്ലാസ്സുകൾ എടുക്കുന്നു. അതിൽ നിന്ന് മാറി സഞ്ചരിക്കേണ്ട കാലം അതിക്രമിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നു എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. ലോക്ക്ഡൗണിൻ്റെ ഈ സമയം നമ്മളെ ബോധ്യപ്പെടുത്തുന്നത്, കൊറോണ വൈറസിൻ്റെ വ്യാപനം, COVID-19 എന്ന മഹാമാരിയെ ലോകത്ത് വിതച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുമ്പോൾ, ലോകം മുഴുവൻ വീട്ടിലടക്കപ്പെട്ട അവസ്ഥയിലായിരുന്നു ഏതാണ്ട് 1.5-2 മാസക്കാലം. അറിവിന് മാത്രം നമുക്ക് മൊറട്ടോറിയം പ്രഖ്യാപിക്കാൻ കഴിയില്ല. സമാനമായ സാഹചര്യങ്ങൾ ഭാവിയിലും ഉണ്ടാകാം. അത്തരം സന്ദർഭങ്ങളിൽ നൂതനമായ സങ്കേതങ്ങൾ അറിവ് പകർന്നു നൽകുന്നതിന് വേണ്ടി പ്രയോജനപ്പെടുത്താൻ സാധിക്കണം. അതിനുതകുന്ന ഒരു പദ്ധതി നമ്മളുടെ സംസ്ഥാനത്ത് എല്ലാ ഉന്നത വിദ്യാഭ്യാസ സ്ഥാപനങ്ങളിലും സ്കൂളുകൾ ഉൾപ്പെടെയുള്ള സ്ഥാപനങ്ങളിലും ആരംഭിച്ചിരിക്കുകയാണ്. തിരുവിതാംകൂർ ദേവസ്വം ബോർഡിൻ്റെ അധീനതയിലുള്ള ശാസ്താംകോട്ടയിലെ കുമ്പളത്ത് ശംഖുപിള്ള സ്മാരക ദേവസ്വം ബോർഡ് കോളേജിൽ IQAC നേതൃത്വത്തിൽ വരുന്ന ഒരാഴ്ചക്കാലം നടത്തപ്പെടുന്ന വിർച്വോസ എന്ന വെബിനാർ സീരീസിന് എല്ലാവിധ ഭാവുകങ്ങളും നേരുന്നു. നമ്മുടെ സംസ്ഥാനത്ത് അധ്യാപനത്തിന് ഒരു പുതിയ യുഗമാണ് ഇതോടുകൂടി കുറിക്കപ്പെടുന്നത്. ഇക്കാലം അത്രയും പിന്തുടർന്നു പോന്ന മാർഗത്തിൽ നിന്ന് നാം വേറിട്ട് സഞ്ചരിക്കാൻ വേണ്ടി തുടങ്ങുകയാണ്. തീർച്ചയായും ഇത് വരും കാലത്തും നമുക്കേറെ പ്രയോജനം ചെയ്യും. ഇത്തരമൊരു സംരംഭത്തിന് മുന്നോട്ട് വന്ന ഇതിൻ്റെ പിന്നണിയിൽ പ്രവർത്തിച്ച എല്ലാവരെയും അഭിനന്ദിക്കുന്നു. ഈ പരിപാടി നല്ല വിജയമാകട്ടെ എന്ന് ആശംസിക്കുകയും ചെയ്യുന്നു.
It is virtually impossible to make any business successful without the support of management. KSMDB college is managed by Travancore Devasam
Board. Travancore Devasam Board college il vechu തീയതികളിൽ നടത്തുന്ന വിർച്വോസ 2020 എന്ന പേരിലുള്ള ഈ വെബിനാർ സീരീസിന് തിരുവിതാംകൂർ ദേവസ്വം ബോർഡിന്റെ എല്ലാ ആശംസകളും അറിയിക്കുകയാണ്. ദേവസ്വം ബോർഡ് കോളേജിലെ ഇന്റേണൽ ക്വാളിറ്റി ഇംപ്രൂവ്മെന്റിന്റെ ഭാഗമായി ഇതാണ് ഈ പരിപാടി സംഘടിപ്പിച്ചിട്ടുള്ളത് എന്നുള്ളതാണ് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കുന്നത്. ഇത് സംഘടിപ്പിക്കുന്ന കാലഘട്ടത്തിലെ ഒരു പ്രത്യേകതയുണ്ട്. ലോകമാസങ്ങളിലും ബാധിച്ചിട്ടുള്ള COVID-19 കാലങ്ങളിലാണ് ഇത് നടക്കുന്നത്. ലോക ചരിത്രത്തിൽ ഇതേവരെ ഉണ്ടാകാത്ത വളരെ വലിയ ഒരു പ്രതിസന്ധിയാണ് ലോകമെമ്പാടുമുള്ള എന്നുള്ളത്. നമ്മുടെ രാജ്യവും നമ്മുടെ സംസ്ഥാനവും ഒക്കെ ഇതിന്റെ ഇരകളാണ്. നമ്മുടെ സംസ്ഥാനത്തെ സംബന്ധിച്ച് കോവിഡ് പ്രതിരോധ നടപടികളുടെ കാര്യത്തിൽ അഭിമാനാർഹമായ ഒരു നേട്ടമാണ് ഉണ്ടാക്കിയെടുക്കുക നമുക്ക് കഴിഞ്ഞു. ഇപ്പൊ കോവിഡ് നമുക്ക് തരുന്ന ചില പാഠങ്ങളുണ്ട്. കോവിഡ് കാലത്ത് നമ്മൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കേണ്ട കുറെ കാര്യങ്ങളുമുണ്ട്. കോവിഡിന് മുൻപുള്ള കാലഘട്ടത്തിൽ വ്യത്യസ്തമായി നൂതനമായ മാർഗങ്ങൾ നമ്മുടെ നിത്യജീവിതത്തിൽ നമ്മൾ ഓരോരുത്തരും പുതിയതായി കണ്ടെത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. പരമ്പരാഗതമായി ഇത്തരം പരിപാടികൾ നടത്തുന്ന രീതി മാറിയിട്ട് വീഡിയോ കോൺഫറൻസിംഗ് വഴി ഉള്ള ഒരു പരിപാടിയാണ് ഇപ്പോൾ എത്തിയിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഈ അടുത്ത കാലത്തായി നടക്കുന്ന പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട പല മീറ്റിങ്ങുകളും കോൺഫറൻസുകളും മറ്റ് ഡിസ്കഷൻസും എല്ലാം തന്നെ വീഡിയോ കോൺഫറൻസിംഗ് വഴിയാണ്. ഈ പ്രധാനപ്പെട്ട ഒരു വിഷയത്തിൽ വീഡിയോ കോൺഫറൻസിംഗ് വഴി നടത്തുന്ന ഈ പരിപാടി തീർച്ചയായും സന്തോഷപ്രദമായ ഒന്നാണ്. ഇതിനെ നേരിട്ട് കൊടുത്ത ആളുകളെ തിരുവിതാംകൂർ ദേവസ്വം ബോർഡ് അഭിനന്ദിക്കും. ശാസ്താംകോട്ട ദേവസ്വം
those who help us think for ourselves. The words of Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, the best teacher we had in our nation. Teachers determine the quality of the people in the society. KSMDV College is blessed with a highly reputed faculty resource who wholeheartedly supported VIRTUOSA2020. Now let me invite Dr. Mini R. Nair, senior faculty member and associate professor of English department, to have a few words.
Namaste. We are all searching for different ways to make life go forward in all its aspects. The present challenge calls for a solution, and the webinar series VIRTUOSA2020 is KSMDB College's answer to the question, what's next? I sincerely appreciate and support the efforts taken by the IQAC of my institution to organize this webinar series, whereby knowledge can be transferred regardless of distance. This is possible under the vibrant leadership of our captain, our respected principal, Dr. K. Tanil Kumar, whose motivation is the guiding force behind this endeavor. I also appreciate and congratulate the efforts of the IQAC convener, Dr. Jayashree, and her brilliant team, who translates the vision of the principal into action. Let us make this platform meaningful. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for your kind words. Now it's time for starting the technical session. May I now invite Dr. JC, IQAC coordinator, to introduce the resource person.
Am I audible?
Yes, madam, you are audible.
I take this opportunity to introduce the resource person. And today's technical session of VIRTUOSA will be handled by Dr. Elizabeth Sherly, professor of triple IT. And I consider myself privileged to introduce Dr. Elizabeth Sherly to this august audience. Dr. Elizabeth Sherly received her PhD in computer science at MK. During the period 2009-2012, she served as the director of the institute, having more than 30 years of experience in teaching and research in computer science. And major research work involves pattern recognition, natural language. She produced PhD students. She is actively working on promoting virtual learning system with a pedagogy model of technology enhanced learning to the educational community. Cloud computing and object modeling technology modeling are also her passionate areas, and she is the executive member of and technical expert member of several government and central government body international for excellence and today there is the night.
Apologies for the technical inconvenience caused in between. Now may I request the resource person to take over the session.
Hello, I'm going to share my slide now. The same problem coming the host participant screen sharing.
Madam, please try once again. Please try once again.
Okay.
Yes, now it's okay.
Yes, yes, yes. But I think it is not in slideshow mode.
No, kindly, it is not in slideshow mode. Make
kindly start the slideshow, ma'am. Normal.
Yes.
Now it's okay, ma'am.
Now it's okay. So I can start the session now. Yes.
Okay, okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me for this webinar series. And I have a long relationship with Dr. Arun Kumar, your principal. Thank you, Dr. Arun Kumar, again for inviting me. And I also express my thanks to all the management and Dr. Jayashree and all for arranging this talk for today. So, as Dr. Arun Kumar has already mentioned, today's scenario we have, so that is, I have chosen a topic like decoding to digital education post-corona. So, this is actually, as you know, all the situations today. 1 minute, please. So the outbreak of COVID-19 pandemic has affected the educational system worldwide, has resulted into the closures of schools, universities, and colleges. You know that about 285 million young learners in India affected that in learning, and still there is an uncertainty when this will reopen. Even some of the examinations in our secondary school exams still has to be conducted. And there is a lot of panic, there is a lot of tension among students, as well as the parents and the management, government, etc. So this is one side where students, teachers, families are affecting this the outspread of this pandemic. But at the same time, in the national level also, it is far-reaching the economic and societal consequences also. So as a whole, this pandemic has significantly disrupted the higher education sector as, and it is a critical determinant for a country's economic future too. So as some of the immediate measures that we have taken during this pandemic is that one is that reinventing the education academic culture using some innovative advanced technologies. Online education system, online learning system, web-enabled systems, virtual learning, these all are not new to all of us. And open source digital learning solutions and all, this is not very new jargons of all of us studying it and all the learners here and the teachers here. And I just given some snaps here, just pre-corona sessions where students are packed in the classroom. The current scenario where the bins are empty, and what we are looking for is a smart classroom where a lot of technologies has to be put in place for continuing our education without any problems to our children. But still many issues, as you know, uncertainty regarding admissions, completion of ongoing courses and future placement of students. I've come up with some of the major concerns what we have. And many institutions have moved their classes to the conferencing mode, video lectures, and using that famous NPTEL contents and all. But my question is that how effectively online classes and video lectures taking place for a mass of students, maybe thousands of students together, 2,000 or 5,000 students of even many of our schools have more than 2,000 or even 5,000 students in a college. So you need to address all the students' things and all of them are at home now, and you cannot expect a good bandwidth or a good connectivity in all the children there. And also what kind of infrastructure they have, what kind of infrastructure that colleges have got. These all are some of the issues still persisting at that. So let us see how the condition is that. There was an article in the week, the May month, and there some survey has taken, and some of the IIT's directors has replied, and even the IIT Bombay has told that they are not ready for tackling the situations, and what even though they have some online courses and NPTEL, they have it. And I just took one of the colleges in Chennai, that is the Hindustan Institute of Technology. There they have 7,000 students enrolled, and what they have done, just this pandemic happened at the time at the middle of the March. So all these students, they started online education using the Microsoft 365. Why I'm saying that they are ahead of thinking such situations, and that they have already got a licenses for enabling 7,000 students in that college. So, and the vice chancellor of Kundriya PI said, he told that he conducts all this regular video meet and heads and all the regular functioning of the colleges by sitting at home. So this is a way how many colleges are equipped. And it is not at all possible, I know that. But we need to address this problem wherever, whenever this kind of pandemic, outbreak, disasters, environmental problems, earthquake or anything comes. So our students cannot be stopped, or our students cannot be put in a close while this kind of destruction happens. I consider, sorry for saying that, that someday this will be this disruption in education, it is a blessing for us. Why this, I'm telling that it is a blessing, that this disruption which happens, it's an inconvenience for the short term, but for the good, it's good for a long term. Why? Because you know that in computer science, we talked about disruptive technologies. Disruptive technologies is that the one technology we stop it and we are not in use, and we will go to another technology. So we use a typewriter for typing, then we have gone to computer for typing. Now we use the mobiles for typing. So these kind of changes, it happened now. Nobody, our children might not even see the typewriter. So that's the way many sectors, many areas, this disruptive technology of changes has been happening, but that's only one area where there is no change at all happening for decades is education. So this is the time, and we still continue with the bricks and mortar infrastructure, face-to-face classroom delivery, very packed classrooms without having much facilities there, and the students, they are structured, some programs there. So they have to attend the physical classes, write exams for marks, prepare for the competition examination. This is a routine kind of educational system we are following. And what is the end result is that the quality of the education is diminishing. Our children are not able to place it or in a very, very highly reputed companies or to at par with international students, how our students stand. So these are some of the questions it has been raising nowadays. So this, given this current challenge, the existing model has to be revamped, and we need to unlearn many things that we are in practice in the education sector. So a paradigm shift for bringing in certain specific intervention changes is required in our education that to make our education more meaningful. Okay, what is that? Reinventing higher education to a digital, by flexible and open learning system to assure the continuity of the learning. Okay, I have given two learning methodologies like flexible and open learning system. It's very difficult to define or define a boundary between a flexible learning system or an open learning system, or what all we can have it in a flexible learning system. But as a definition,
flexible learning system is a set of educational approaches and systems concerned with providing learners with the increased choice, convenience, and personalization to suit their needs. In particular, flexible learning provides learners with a choice about where, when, and how the learning occurs, and it's using a range of technologies to support the teaching and learning. This can be a formal way or an informal way, because our education system, we are always looking for an accreditation and certificates and all. So it can be defined as a formal way, because the university or the college can set the guidelines and the rules for having a formal education and an informal education using this flexible model. This is where the technology can be used in a very advanced manner, and this is a learner-centric educational strategy. And this provides the choices from the main dimension of the structure, the studies, such as time and location of learning, resources for teaching and learning, instructional approaches, learning activities, support for teachers and learners. In this way, teaching and learning can be flexible rather than fixed. This can help promote easy, engaged, and effective learning. This is a very debatable kind of approach, where how do we define the flexible structure for that, and how do the students can earn their credits and write examinations and all. So this formal kind of flexible learning, the credits and the examination schemes, and this all will be defined, and students have to follow that without any changes in that. So, but students can choose what kind of methodology they want to learn it, and they can.
Excuse me, ma'am. Ma'am, shall I interrupt you for a while?
Yes.
Ma'am, can you increase the volume of your system? Because many are complaining that they are not audible.
Is it audible now?
Let me check, madam. Please be there for a while. Okay, ma'am?
Okay.
Madam, can you arrange this one, the volume by maximum, not the automatic volume adjustment, madam?
I put the maximum, actually.
Oh.
Ma'am, one more solution. If you could remove the earphone and
talk. I will try that.
Okay, ma'am.
Hello.
Clear.
Is it audible now?
Now it's clear, ma'am.
Okay. So should I continue from the beginning, or shall I?
No, ma'am. You can continue. And one more request, kindly give the slide view if you could.
Hello, I can't hear it from there.
Okay, ma'am, please continue.
Continue.
You can hear me.
Okay.
Yeah, clear.
Please continue, ma'am, please.
Okay, so another way of learning is that open learning systems. Open learning aims to make learners more self-determined and independent, while teachers become more of a learning facilitator only. Teachers will be there, but teachers will become act as a mentor or a facilitator. So students, children, learners has got all the freedom to choose the way they want to learn. And it's not as a formal kind of thing, I think, but university or colleges can define it in the formal way also, because they should be, but it's not as rigid as the existing systems. So there can be a different practices of learning into this. And it's a control of the learner. But learners should be more free to have their own time of learning, the pace of the learning, because there is no time frame also. Even as far as the definition is concerned, there is no time frame to complete their studies. It can be a extended time they can have it, and so that they can learn it in their own pace. So they can enroll even for a one module or a full course, or they can take one module from one college or a one university or some other modules from a foreign university. And only thing is that credit has to be transferred to here, and that has to be matched with our accreditation policies and all. So, like students have got lot of flexibility in choosing their topics and writing their examinations and how to go about all this kind of activities in the learning process. So it is fully an online mode of teaching, and but it is slightly different from the distance education system that we are familiar with that. And the submission, evaluation, certificate can all be online. But it will be, wherever he has taken that course, it will be monitored, and the management of that course will be run by that particular university. So that part only the left to the college and all other things, the learner can do it in his own interest. Okay, can you audible now?
Yes, ma'am. You can continue, ma'am.
Okay, so these are some of the, you know, open learning technologies that we can use it for that. This is, I have taken to the State University of New York, where it's a very typical kind of a diagram only, nothing great in that. So you should have a virtual environment in that. You have a streaming facility there. So there should be a lot of materials available for them. Even for this open learning, the colleges or universities should be equipped to provide the learning materials, and you should have a separate section. You cannot mix it with your regular kind of courses and degree. It's a separate session, just like as a distance education, it's a separate kind of thing. And these are the modules you'll be given for open. These are the courses you are given for the open. What are the guidelines to be followed that, and all it should be written separately as an academic regulations, and where all the technology, whatever you require, it should be provided with that. So you should be more of technology equipped to conduct such courses also. Now, you know, the one of the other victims in this educational system, if I use victims, I don't know it's correct or not, are teachers. When we transform this to a digital kind of education from the normal bricks and mortar rules, so whether our teachers are happy or unhappy. So a lot of transitions has been taking place, from transition from chalk and board to virtual classroom, from classes to online assessments, from oral lessons to PPT-based learning, from in-person conversation to interactions on platforms like Zoom and Microsoft Teams, from paper correction to online exams and grading. Teachers have to traverse a long to unbeaten path of this online classes in video mode, practically work to transfer learning materials to online materials. Oh, lot of work, very heavy work. So a lot of transition in the side of teachers also. So this is all on a sudden, it is happening as far as the schools are concerned. Colleges are also, maybe for a engineering or a technology, computer science teachers, the transition may be more easy for them, but there are a lot of other subjects, art subjects, science subjects and all. Teachers are not that much equipped to do that, so they should also be transformed into that learning. So initially, of course, you know, there should be some problem with that. But once they have come into this kind of learning or a digital learning structure, so teachers, this transition will admit in a full sense, because, and many teachers are very innovative, but our curriculum, our rigid kind of syllabuses, it will not allow the teachers to give lot of experimentation or the way they need it. They are all thinking about the question paper, how they examine it, how the university question paper will come, and how do this, my students write the examination for that and score more marks. So that is the only outcome, learning outcome they are looking at for giving a portion to that. They cannot apply any innovative in that. But here, what we can do is that teachers can also come up with a lot of innovative ideas, and this can be, ideas can be more focused in that. Teachers can also, depending on what kind of learning you opt, the time and locations, so free from routine and the board work, you know, the teachers should be, even most of the colleges and schools, they should be at 9 o'clock. If it becomes 9:05, the principal will not allow you to even mark your attendance. So this kind of system has to be changed, because wherever you are, your time for this class, your time for giving a particular schedule, that's what you have to look at. You don't need to look at what all the full day schedule into that. That way it won't work. And also running from one class to the other class after one period, when even they may not get 5 minutes rest also. So this will all affect the performance of the teaching and ultimately go to the students' performance also. So here also teachers can set their time, or they have a flexible learning schedule, and the information can be shared. Very good experts teaching material, and also their video lectures can be shared and that can be reused. And one other advantage as far as the teachers is concerned are the reusability. Once they have recorded or a video lectures they have taken or some materials they have already created, it can be used it again. They don't need to repeat it again. So initially they have a lot of troubles and a lot of work, but later they'll really enjoy and they get lot of time to do some other very innovative activities also. So coping, even teachers can also coping with the state of the art learning system. So next part, the requirement. Requirement, the first and the most important thing is infrastructure. Infrastructure, when we talk about everything, it comes under infrastructure, isn't it? And most thing is connectivity. Even though you have all the infrastructure, everything is in place, if you don't have a good bandwidth or a connectivity, your all things will be in collapse. So providing better connectivity is a big issue. And the students, they are into different locations. Even though any of the colleges, they have good servers, good facility and good infrastructure, good bandwidth. But in the remote end, the students, if they don't have the connectivity, your all effort will be in vain. So how do we alleviate from these problems? Learning tools. And the video, as you know that now there are a lot of video conference tools coming. And these are the things everybody know. I don't need to explain a lot. Even learning tools, it comes with the content management system, learning management systems, and video conferencing. So video conferencing tools also, the main thing is that nowadays, you know that there are a number of video conferencing tools for education coming in. But how do you choose that? You should be very careful in choosing that. The main problem is that you should run it in a low cost connectivity also. Low connectivity with the video and how many they can accommodate, the scalability and the cost, the licensing, the security. You have to consider all these factors to select a good video conferencing tool for that. Learning resources, it can be the learning materials also, where teachers has to put a lot of effort in that. And maybe we can reuse some of the existing good teachers' learning materials also and share it among our students. But these all are the things everybody know, but you should follow a pedagogy model for teaching and learning. And how do we choose this pedagogy model? There actually the question of university constrained rules, constrained regulations, accreditations will come into question. So in this kind of scenario, if you are looking for a transformation, every college or every institution should have the autonomy. Nowadays, you know that some of the colleges are getting autonomy so that they can conduct the examination, they can prepare the syllabus as their own, and they can do everything as their own. So every college should attain that kind of autonomy in that. And the college has to define the pedagogy model, what they have to follow it. And this can be flexible and this can be, what's called, you can reorient it according to your need, your students, your kind of participants, all you have it. So that kind of things comes only this kind of digital education will run. Otherwise, it's very difficult to come under the UGC or the AICT or an NAC accreditation. Now, if you look at the national education policy headed by Kasturi Rangan, you must read that. So there are a lot of innovation and thought processing there in that. They are putting it in a very highly, technology oriented and a very highly thinking policy into that. If
If we can adopt that way into our colleges, and if we get the permission from the universities or the UGC, then it is good for us. And by the at the same time, collaboration between government enterprises and universities. Okay, one thing I am missing it is that collaboration with the foreign universities. If we have the autonomy to do that, then we have to go for a collaboration with the foreign universities, where students' mobility has also been defined. Students' mobility means now in Corona, I can't say that students or faculty have to move or they have to, and vice versa. But even foreign universities, there are a lot of foreign universities, they are also offering a lot of online courses that can be taken by our students also. But now the advantage is that the cost, so we don't need to travel, travel fare is not coming, you don't need to have any accommodation there. So with the minimum cost, or maybe the registration fee or the course fee, you can have courses from the foreign good to foreign universities, and you should have a system to consider that credit and to map to our systems like that. So what we define is that what is a minimum credit that you can occur to get a degree. But a student can go maximum of business credit also. So this will give you added advantage and knowledge to our students, and this will, they'll suit more for or an employability and the knowledge also. And of course, infrastructure level, hardware, bandwidth, software, this all, everybody knows it. I think I don't need to explain too much on this. As a whole, I put infrastructure all together. What here, maybe I don't need to explain all the things. You have a smart classroom. And one thing everybody are familiar with, that with the cloud-based system there. So the learning resources, the e-learning platforms that they use, you can, one way you can put it in a cloud, but cloud, you know, the advantage is that you don't need to maintain the server, you don't need to have that server and the bandwidth here and all that, all they'll take care of. But the maintenance cost, the space that they occupy, the cost and all, you should work out with the legal agreement and all, and you need to see which one is more economical in that way, and then you can go for a cloud-based e-learning system. Many of you know Moodle. Moodle is one of the very popular learning management system, has been successfully using it in many institutions and foreign universities. But recently this Moodle has come up with a Moodle cloud, where you can post, then you can directly post it in the Moodle cloud, and it is in a bit licensed, but in a very reasonable rate only. So that's why they can manage everything, and you just act as a client and then get the benefit out of that. So then a video content library, you should have a very good online library. Teacher and parent meeting, the colleges, you know, one or two times in any year, you will conduct parent teacher teaching meetings. So parent has to come to the school or college, and do, it's a one day program for that. So no need for that. If we have a very good academic management system, everything about the student are available for the parent also. Any messages, any alert, anything, you can send it at any time. And the parent teacher and student interaction is real time, so that there is no need for a separate parent-teacher meeting, etc. Remote classroom facility. I'll come to the classroom facility in my later slides. So, so video-enabled learning management system, where when we come to the earlier, you know that many of us, we don't go for video, just go for the learning management systems, where when you come to the video, bandwidth is a main problem. So we have to address that also. Okay, now coming to, I just put in the topic as in-classroom learning in post-COVID-19. So how do we change our classroom? Because the problem is now that current our classrooms are packed with the students. There is a system like teachers in the classroom will walk around and discuss and see how the students are doing. They will also clear the doubts, where maybe one or two students will come and face to face very close to the teacher. They will explain.
staff rooms also tightly packed with the number of teachers. Attendance and other regulations they have to follow. Evaluation camp, meetings and assemblings. So there is some culture of, you know, the assembly in the morning and all have to come together. So meetings also in a small rooms we have to conduct it. And many extracurricular activities like sports, arts and all, you have to do it. But current scenario, if you look at, you have to stop all this. Then how do we conduct your classes? So this is a new classroom that I am envisaging. That I have not put all the things, but only minor things I put it. We have to follow social distancing now. So see, look at the classroom that we have now. You can maximum two students you can accommodate in a bench, and they have to wear the mask. Then how do we do it? The current teaching into the mass of students. One way is that you can have batch classes. You can have bigger classroom, but since our classrooms are already there, it's very difficult to have a bigger classroom. But one easy way is that abolish one of the walls between two classes and make it as a bigger one. But other thing is that make batch classes where set of students will come in this many days and set of students maybe they alternate days classes. If you have a very good online system, the other days when they sit at home, they will do all the exercises. But you have to be packed with exercises, assignments, and teachers' load is more in the initial stage. And whether the teacher is present in the classroom or not, it can be either way. Maybe teacher can also come into the classroom, or they can teach from remotely. If they teach it remotely, or they can use the facility of a college, it should be a noiseless, and you should have studios in the college. How many studios? You have to conduct maybe 15 or 10 classes together, or maybe it can be in the recorded manner or live streaming classes. So this has to be arranged accordingly. Meetings, you should need a bigger room with a distance keeping kind of things. So a lot of alternatives has to become in colleges to conduct the classes now. This is a new class that we can envisage it. So maybe separate desk, not as benches, where maybe one student in a desk, and it can be separated with some blocks. And you can have a remotely engaged teacher or in the classroom teachers. And you have an interactive board, and there are a number of cameras, videos, etc. And also the classroom structure itself has to be changed from the our conventional classrooms. So one main question I think everybody might have raised or thought about it. Even I don't know, even my lecture here, seminar here, how many are keenly attending it? Because I'm not seeing your face, and whether you are sitting it in front of the computer also, I don't know. This is called affect detection. So students' attention is very important in a learning performances. So major concerns that we have is students' attention, mood, interest, their behavior, etc. And students, you know that when we are in class, if they are not interested, they just gesture changes and all. By changing that gesture changes and all, we know that he is not attending the class. But when we go for online classes, how do we know that any changes there, whether the mood is changing, whether he is not listening and all. So we need a sustained attention during an online synchronous instruction. Synchronous instruction is real time. When you give a class, all has to be attended at that time itself. So this is a very big research area also. So sustained education is the ability to focus on an event or a stimuli for a long period of time, as long as it is finished. It's an active research area in affect detection in learning, but it's a bit tricky, and it needs certain devices also. And this all, what we do is that what kind of changes it happened in your brain, that is capturing. That kind of methodology, we call it as a brain-computer interfaces. So how do we get the signals from the brain and analyze it? So there is a new paradigm of it's not at all machine learning, maybe comes in the artificial intelligence and cognitive computing, that is called brain computing, where what we can do is that you can capture the signals from your brain and amplify it, digitize to a computer, and you can analyze it. And this is a very hot research area, even in the today's learning system. So what we are doing is that attention, many things we can do it. One area is that attention monitoring and alarm mechanism based on the brain-based signal that to improve the learning performance via monitoring the attention of a state individual. I just show you some kind of work on it. Before that, how do we capture the information? What kind of signals we take it from brain? So just to understand that, I'll just show you some of the parts of the brain where you have a temporal lobe, you have occipital lobe, you have a parietal lobe. So these are the different sections in that. It means that if you have a frontal lobe, certain kind of signals will come from there. That will be for a certain activity. So if you have a temporal lobe, what kind of activities it comes? If you have a parietal lobe, what kind of activities come? Activities in the sense, attention, your motivation, your speech, your memory, this all the. So if you wanted to get a signal of attention, you need to get the signal maybe from the temporal lobe. So frontal lobe, what all the way you get the personality, behavior, emotions, judgment, planning, problem solving, speaking and writing, body movement. So as I said, the gesture movements are not intelligence, concentration, self-aware. These are all the things it is required for a learning, lots of learning parameters in that. So what exactly we are doing, it's a cognition process. So it's a kind of cognition computing also. So cognitive functions, that's some mental process where whatever the input they receive it, they do some processing and maybe they do it analysis, certain kind of actions, and it will extract, come as a different stimulate to the outside world. So all this process like emotions, your memory, your behavior, your attitude, your attention, this all are cognitive process, and certain cognitive process, you can process it using taking the signals, but certain process you don't need to take it as is from the signal, because getting signal from the brain is a difficult task. I'll just explain in another one of two slides how it can be taken out. And gesture, if you just look at the gesture, so how do we get it at gesture? If you have photos, if you have images, how this person is changing it, how the children is changing it and all. So that is a gestural analysis, and how the body changes happened, and how his face is changing. So this kind of things you can get it from image. So this is a multimodality kind of actions and multimodality process involved in that. And text is also a part of that. So those who are in the computer science, maybe you heard of what the natural language processing, where the text processing, speech analysis, this all comes into place. So there are a lot of areas in this, and it's a very massive research area also. And fortunately, I am also into some of these research areas, and I have this learning performance also a part of my research area in this, where I have just have cognitions, where exactly this attention comes, memory comes, creativity comes. So these are the factors it makes a child in a learning process. So if we can extract that signals directly from the brain, so you'll be able to know how best the student is listening and how best he is doing in any activity in that. So cognitive neuroscience emotions, what we can do is that when you are happy, a happy signal can be sent to your signal can be taken and sent to your computer. A when you are angry, when you are worried, excited, that kind of signals can be interpreted, and it signals will be taken, amplified, digitized, and analyzed it, and you will be able to see how he is angry or he is worried, etc. So a lot of thought process has to be taken place in this, but there are a lot of researches going on this. And the question now maybe comes into your mind is, how do you get the signal from your brain? So normally, how do when we go to the hospital or any health problem you have, how do we take brain signals? You know about EEG, MRI, and all. So so these are some of we called non-invasive kind of devices where you don't need to place any rod, electrode or anything inside your brain. It can be outside. Here I can see a boy sitting with an EEG cap on his head. So there are a lot of methodologies to get the signal from there. But problem with an educational institution or in the perspective of a student's learning system, these all are very costly and it is not affordable for us. And also we need technician to, operate these kind of things. So this is something very difficult for a layman's work is concerned or any kind of research organizations also. But there are certain good, centers even in IIT Bombay, IIT Delhi, IIT Chennai, then Central University Hyderabad, Symbiosis in Pune. They all are doing it in this level of activities also. And Triple IITM also into some kind of direction into this. And this girl, you can see, it's not merely a headphone. This is something, some sensors are placed here to extract the signals. So now what we need is that there are certain low cost, this kind of devices available. And using this, you can extract signals from there. One example that we also use is called the MUSC Muse. So it can be a different channels also, for channel 16 channel, etc. Depending on the channels, we have the price, the cost will be different. So, but if you have a 16 channel, you get more information in there. But still, what happened is that this signals frequency and getting good signals is a difficult task. There should be a lot of noises in that. Even then, the frequency distribution may not be correct. So a lot of pre-processing has to be done it after taking the signals also. So signal acquisition, we do it with any of these techniques and it has to be pre-processed. Then this kind of, what are the features you needed, like, attention or behavior or mood or something, that all the features has to be extracted. And you have to do some attention, machine learning techniques to process that and come into a certain kind of knowledgeable or meaningful result into that. This is a very active area, but I just show you some of the multimodal way of getting the this kind of behavioral attitude. You can have a sensor-free and a sensor-based, because sensor is the one it is putting us in this kind of, headphones or even like different kind of sensor systems are there. It can be text-based, audio-based, image-based, or video-based, or a sensor, brain signal, brain image, skin conductance-based, heart rate, whether there are a number of methods, but mainly now the work is on a brain signal and a brain image method. But MRI also, fMRI images a little bit, but that's way, even for this particular application, we won't go for that. And if you go to any hospitals also, they won't ready to give such kind of images for us. So we need to rely on some of the devices like, as I said, Muse or MB to extract the signals from there. So many things, as I already told, from the audio part, speech recognition, sentiment analysis, facial expression. Eye tracking is another way of identifying the student's mood or attention. There are eye tracking glasses available. Some of you may be knowing it. So as you know that if when we go for a sleep in the classroom, your eyes will eyes ball will go down, or if your attention is changing to a different direction, you will change to that. So that changes will be captured, and how you are attending your classes or how your mood is changing will be able to. So you have eye tracking glasses available now, and gesture analysis I already told you, and video surveillance can also be in place. Then another thing is that the natural language processing to understand the text and analyzing the text. So this is, in fact, a lot of researches are there. So this is an online learning environment with an interactive systems, how it comes in there. This is a work done in Taylor and Francis journal. It has come, and there the teacher, you can see it, teacher is providing the content or a teaching, and student, he will view like this. And there are number of students there. This is, as I said, not merely a headphone. It is a sensor-based headphones or like that. Here you can see an interactive screen where what we do is that each student name and their activities will be displayed. And one teacher assistant is here. Depending on where what it shows it in this screen, she will give alert to the student. Hey, Lakshmi, you are not listening it, or you are sleeping. Come on. So this kind of attention mechanism, interactive tools are available now, but students should have this kind of state of the art technology or devices also. So this is again an online monitoring system. You can see all the students' name and whatever they are doing it, it can be captured. And what it is, depending on the frequency of your actions will come, and it will be interpreted, and they'll identify the level of their attention, and they know that how much it affects. And with this, the performance analysis can be done, and they have found that the students having less attention, their performance is also less. So this is the map, the way, because you must have seen how the ECG or EEG plot comes. Likewise, you can have a plot like this there. Attention, multi-channel attention is comes if you have no signals because nothing is doing, and the frequency level of 0 to 40, 41 to 60. So that way the plot will come. That will also help us to know how this student is attending it. So this is something we need to incorporate maybe in future in our system if you go for a full online kind of system. So you don't need to worry about how, because now what we see is that students will log on and go and do some other work. We don't know whether they are even sitting on the chair in front of the computer. So this kind of things, it cannot happen it by using this method. But coming into that level, it may take some time. But it's in the very near future. This is some video, I think it's not coming. Anyway, nothing great in this, it's a funny video. So if I keep that, it's nothing to lose. So as a conclusion, what I have to say is that prepare and ready for remedy and mitigation strategies to take care of students without affecting their learning in the outbreak of any pandemic, environmental hazards, and other disasters. You should be ready to face this kind of situation without affecting the students or their learning procedures. So this kind of learning changes has to be happened in our students also. And what I wanted to conclude is that the recent announcement from the National Ministry, so National Initiatives on Education, Finance Minister has recently announced it. So what she is telling is that there are 12 different channels and one for each classroom, because this is mainly for remote located people where low connectivity or no connectivity at all. So you will have a different channels for each schools, and the channel kind of transmission will take place for this. And other thing is, 100 university online class facility. So they'll be supporting 100 university or for an online time facility. And ultimately what they're looking for, one nation, one platform. I don't know when it will come in, but we'll really looking forward to have such of one nation with one platform, or even otherwise, if you give a very good funding from an online classroom facility, so you will be more equipped to have such kind of changes or transition in colleges where students will not be affected wherever or whenever or any kind of disaster happens. Thank you very much. This is my presentation, and finally, I wish stay inspired through effective learning. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Madam, there is a question in the question answer session. The first question is, can you hear me, ma'am?
1 minute, let me use my incoming, this is better for me, my speaker.
Okay. Shall I ask a question, ma'am?
Yeah, sure.
The question is, will eye tracking be a practical method in online learning and examination?
Eye tracking, examination, because we need glasses for each student, and it is very costly also. So we need, the only thing is that this all kind of things, we need to come up with a low-cost glasses, low-cost devices. Then only it is affordable and it can be applied to the examinations and also in the classroom. What we can do is that if you go for an online kind of methods in the classroom with a limited number of students, as I told, a batch by batch, then maybe if you have a 10 or 15 classes, this can be implemented, and the next batch when it comes to the same can be implemented. But the same, or can be, all the students has to be enrolled in your server for getting their signals or changes.
Okay, ma'am, thank you. Another question is, technology is not neutral. The crisis will be manipulated to privatizing education. What is your response regarding this?
Technology is not neutral in the sense technology will change. There is no problem in that. Why the technology is changing? For the betterment of life. So whatever the changes it happened, it using technology, that we have just, our life become more easier only. That doesn't make a problem to you. So wherever, because now tomorrow you don't have, you may not use a mobile. You may have a very imaginary screen on in front of you, and there you can see all the things. So that way it will make your life easy only. So don't worry about technology. What is the next question?
Next question is, can you comment on MIT open online course and some online learning platform for computer science and engineering?
MIT's?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you talking about the MOOC?
Not online open course, open online courses launched by MIT, Massachusetts.
I know that MIT's courses and all, but I cannot comment anything more on their courses as such. But they are successfully doing it, the open courses now.
Yes, I think they can search on the web for their courses.
Now you know that Coursera is available in free. Coursera is a very good course materials, and it is an online course. Earlier it was a highly paid one. Now due to this coronavirus outbreak, it become free. And using that Coursera kind of materials and classes, it is a very good thing for our students also. So that's why I told you that if our students can attend one Coursera course, and that can be added as a credit to our students, that has to be put it in place of your academic regulations. That's the way the academic regulations and all has to be changed. Even with this, our rigid academic regulation, this will not happen. That has to be break. It has to be broken.
Okay, ma'am. Then another
question from Shiv Om Pratap. He is asking whether experimental learning on the UG and PG level, especially for biology, is practically possible.
Yeah, this is another good question, because those subjects which has got an intensive wet labs or labs, how do we do that? So this kind of things, we need to have some kind of in lab kind of experience also. But many experience can be simulated using a computer or a certain modeling kind of thing. But that will not give the full effect of that. But at the same time, certain kind of things you need to have them in classroom or in lab kind of activities.
Okay, ma'am. Then another question is, how come the online classes impact the students than classroom teaching?
We need to change our attitude. So we always have a thing that classroom teaching is the only way of learning methodology. That has to be changed, not only to the student, even to the teachers and parents. I know there are a number of children, very good parents, children, they do home learning. Why they are preferring home learning and they are not seeing anything great by sending out their children to a school? So, yes. But they are successfully doing it. He's a very bright student. So we have to unlearn many of the concepts or attitudes that we have. Otherwise, these changes, this paradigm shift will not happen.
Okay, ma'am. There is on your screen. Can you see a poll, ma'am? On the bottom of your. Can you please launch it?
Yes.
And in the meanwhile, you can make Dr. Ajesh as host.
No, ma'am. After this, only after
how do you rate this
launching
this
the poll.
This is for me, eh?
Yeah. No, ma'am. For attendees.
Okay, this is. I have to click up launch polling.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And we can give at least 3 minutes for completing this launching, this polling, ma'am. After that, you can change the host.
Okay.
You can make Ajesh as host.
Okay.
Dr. Ajesh.
Yes.
After this polling, ma'am.
Yes.
Can I ask you a question, ma'am?
Yes, sure.
Okay, it was actually an excellent presentation. It was very lively also, and it gave a new perspective towards learning, digital learning also. My question is actually like what we call, you told some methods, everything, like senses, everything. What can you give us any 3 tips which you follow in digital learning process so that we can also try to implement it?
What is the first statement? Can you give any
3 tips which you personally follow in the digital teaching process?
Okay, so this is all personalized kind of way you have to go it. So we need to define our pedagogy of a teaching methodology depending on what kind of infrastructure you have and what kind of facilities you have. So flexible, formal kind of teaching is a one for our current situation we can follow.
Okay.
But it should be equipped with a lot of pedagogy model and also technology enhanced learning. So students, we need to face situation when any other kind, this kind of disaster happens without breaking our students' classes. Now all the classes are just closed. So this cannot happen. And you don't expect any disaster to come to this there. But even otherwise, let us have a culture of having online classes, students sitting at home and doing the classes and all. And wherever it is applicable, whether it is in classroom, let them enjoy with that also. Because social being is one of the very important for you studying it in your curriculums, in your school. So that you may miss when you go for an online home teaching. But peer-to-peer contacts and the parents should be, here the other main concern is that the parents' involvement. Parents' involvement is very big when children are at home and they are learning it. So you have to look after, the parents have to look after their exercises, how they are doing it, and how much time they are spending, materials, whether they are able to cope up with that, they will be understand all. The parents should have a big role in that. So they cannot escape. Now, some of the parents, they are feeling that, okay, I will send my children to the school and I relate. This will not happen.
Okay, thank you. One more question, Kim.
Yes.
Okay. ma'am, how to keep please.
Ma'am, a question from Dr. Sujay Kumari. How can the students with financially weak background can access such digital platforms?
One main thing is that you need to have at least a device or a computer or even a mobile to view your content. And I think many of them have got mobile. Mobile is not a big problem there. But the main concern is connectivity. By understanding that problem in large at length, so now this central government has come up with a new kind of learning methodology using TV channels. So they can view all the even different channels for 12 different channels. They are coming to coming with that, and that is a one way they can use it if they have a problem of connectivity. So that is a remedy that now the central government is permitting it. Let us see how best it will run.
Okay. Then, ma'am, another question is there in the question-answer box. How to keep students engaged in online classroom and stop them from misbehaving?
This is what I have talked about in the end of my course. Am I?
Yeah.
The sensors available.
We need to have some monitoring. And one of the things is that don't go for a long classes. Even our attention also, we can have the class. Earlier, the period of time for a class, you cannot go more than 40 minutes. So this is the maximum time, even hours can also sit in without having any disruption. So you don't go for a long classes. There are something like learning objects. Learning objects are like what it says that you have only one thing in place. So maybe one video at a time, or one image where with some text information to learn it. So certain learning object and learning objects, the definition is that it cannot go more than 15 minutes. So that kind of capsule kind of things that can be given to the children when they go for online learning. That is one way of doing it.
Okay.
Learning objects, and we can have chatbots to ask some questions and whether they are bored it and all, and what you have to do it in meanwhile, what is his problems, and you can analyze that. So those kind of some refreshment also you can advise during this course. The chatbot will take care of that kind of things.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Now,
kindly stop sharing the screen.
Yes, polling.
No, ma'am, you have to first make... Madam, please, please make Dr. Ajesh as host. Please make.
Okay, I got two participants.
No, ma'am, no.
Analyst.
Dr. Ajesh.
Yes.
Make host.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Then you stop sharing the screen.
Okay. Stop video. Sharing screen.
Stop sharing. There is an option. Stop sharing.
It's in the top?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. Stop share.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. It's now okay. Ajesh.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Ajesh, there are some raised hands in the attendees list. Can you ask them the questions to them? Can you open their mic, audio?
Okay. One minute, ma'am. Dr. Preetha G. Prasad. Dr. Preetha G. Prasad, are you on the line?
Her audio is blocked.
Kindly unmute your audio and talk. Dr. Preetha G. Prasad.
Sir, it was a mistake. It was a mistake. By mistake, I have raised the hand.
Okay.
Dr. Pushpinder Kumari. Dr. Pushpinder Kumari. Are you on the line? Kindly unmute your microphone and you can talk now. Pushpinder Kumari. Lieutenant Dr. Shaiju GJ. Are you on the line? Dr. Shaiju GJ.
He unmuted his.
Yes, sir.
Sir, you can talk now, sir.
It isn't a very effective session, sir. I'm very happy to hear the wonderful sessions. It's very informative. And I am very lucky person to got this opportunity. I thankful to all the organizers, especially the principal of the college, and also the coordinator, IQAC coordinator, Dr. Jayasri ma'am, and the full team. I'm extend my hearty thanks to all the team. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shaiju.
Okay.
Welcome for your present. We are happy to have you in the attendees list. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Okay.
Ajesh, one more raised hand is there. One Miss M. Jyoti.
Miss Jyoti, you can talk now.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. This is a really wonderful session. I have a very small question. What if an e-content is already prepared? Do you think it becomes year after year? How can we stop this?
Content preparation.
Hello?
Kindly repeat the question, ma'am.
Okay. It is really important to prepare e-content. But once an e-content is prepared and we let it to digitalize, do you think it becomes monotonous year after year? People may use the same content that is prepared. How can we differentiate this from traditional method of teaching?
Shirley, ma'am, are you there?
Hey, yes. Please repeat the question.
Ma'am, we prepare any content. Once we prepare any content, it may be repeatedly used year after year.
Okay.
So how do we highlight this, the traditional education?
Okay, so this is in fact, the attitude of the faculty, because there are number of faculty, they keep on updating their slides or materials even before each class.
Yes.
But there are faculty, they have prepared some lectures maybe 10 years before and use it. So that... So I see that it is the attitude of the teacher. You can't do anything on this. Because there is no mechanism. Because the mechanism in our existing system is that whether the teacher is going to the class or the teacher spending 1 hour of classes on that. What he is teaching inside, there is no other way of capturing. But this kind of things, you know, the recording is there. The students' feedback is real time, and the content updation, this all, how much is taking place, this all can be incorporated in this online management systems also. That way you'll be able to easy to identify or the changes or who all them are doing their curriculum updation or a classroom teaching in better way and all. So even with the new system, it is easy for us to catch it.
Dr. Anjana Tiwari, you want to talk? Kindly unmute.
Yes, hello.
Yes. Kindly talk.
Yes, thank you. Thanks, Mool. I'm from humanity, like my subject is Sanskrit. So many times we feel that students, those come from rural areas. So that's a challenge, one can challenge it. So how we can maintain the online classes for all?
You mean the content or the participation?
Yes, content or participation. The problem is network or training, but content, how we can develop the content, because some students not understand, have faced a language problem and other kind of problems. So what kind of content we need to develop?
Nowadays, I think different language platforms are available, editors are available. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Different kind yes. of language platforms are available, editing tools are available, and in Sanskrit also it is there, I know.
So yes.
Either use this kind of any tools to create your content, and students can directly view that. And another way is that I just talked about, even in my last of the slides, about text, the interpretation. So this is not an easy process. Once you typed it into English, it can be converted into your language, or you can use transliteration.
Yes, I use the same, ma'am.
That is the right now, that is the only two methods you can apply. But actual machine, so called a machine translation from one language to another language, it's a very difficult and complex work. There are works going on that, but depending on the domain and all, because it's all dictionary based and domain based translation we do
it. Yeah, sure.
So that will take, but transliteration is a better method that we can do it.
Okay, thank you, madam. It's very informative and very useful for us. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think there are no more questions in the Q&A box, and also in the there is no more raised hands on the attendees list also. So, Sanu, shall we go to the next session?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. We can do a vote of thanks and inform the attendees regarding tomorrow's plan, tomorrow's schedule. Sorry.
Principal is on the line. Principal is on the line.
Sir, can you say a few words, sir? Anil Kumar, sir. Could you please say something?
Your mic is mute.
Yes, one of the excellent talk relating to the present scenario. And actually, it is most probably focused mainly the latest trends in the technology that can be adopted for the implementation of teaching learning process in the COVID context. Excellent talk by ma'am, and so thanks for the kind cooperation from your side to cooperate with us. Thank you
Thank you very much. Thank you very much again to all the organizers, and especially to you, Dr. Anil. Okay, bye.
What of thanks, Romain, ma'am?
Now, one second, just a word of thanks. We have a formal conclusion.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
So now it is to propose the vote of thanks. Madam, your class was very excellent, and you have addressed all the problems that we are going to face during the online presentation. The connectivity problem, then the attention problem from students, and the understanding related problems, etc. So it was very nice. It was a very nice presentation, ma'am. As far as the connectivity is concerned, we for the last 2 days we are really facing so many problems related to poor connectivity. Today also we are in such a dilemma that whether we could go on air. So that is the problem. That is a severe problem, madam. That is what we are facing. Even in our college is situated in a rural place. Implementing this type of teaching to all students is still a question, because they are not having the connectivity, as well as they are not also having any smart devices for attending this type of classes. Anyway, let us hope for the best. We can improve our facilities, tool wise as well as technical wise facilities in the coming year. Anyway, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your nice presentation.
Thank you.
Now, just for formality, I would like to thank Dr. Anil Kumar sir for his support and encouragement. Thank you, sir. Then now I think I have to thank all the attendees for their patient hearing. And once again, I would like to say a sorry that we have some problem in the beginning. So again, sorry for that. Again, once again, I would like to thank you all for your kind attention. Okay, thank you. Then there is an announcement for the tomorrow session. Tomorrow we are having the sixth day of the webinar series VIRTUOSA 2020, and we will have Dr. J. Prasad, Pro Vice Chancellor of Central University of Kerala, with us to talk about the financial problems that we are going to face after this COVID-19. That is, the topic is actually the COVID post-COVID-19 world order. That will be the topic. So we expect all of you again tomorrow at 2 p.m. Okay. Thank you. Thank you once again.
Thank you, madam. Now we are coming to the end of fifth day session of VIRTUOSA 2020. From the bottom of my heart, I wish to thank you all for being part of the session. The session will end now and see you all tomorrow. Thank you.
Ajay, would you please share the host?
Yeah. I shared, ma'am.
Okay.
Thanks. Thanks to mini teacher.
Now, shall we wind up?
Yes.
Okay,
end the meeting, ma'am.
Okay, sir. So, I'm going to end the meeting, sir.
Okay, teacher. Okay. Let us conclude.
Okay. Thank you, sir.